Hi, this is Dave Dirks of Dirks Outdoors. This is part two of this video series I did with a great tire called Kat Rollin. Kat, if you watch the first series, specializes in tying flies in hand, which means without a vise, which is not easy to do, but actually Kat makes it look pretty easy. And anyway, I thought it was very interesting. She tied, again, a fly that basically she tied this fly during the video taping that we did at the show. Enjoy this second part of our series on tying flies in hand with Kat Rollin.
All right, next we're going to put a tail on. Now, the tail sets the proportion for your entire fly. If your tail is too short or too long, your wing will be too long or too short. So what I do for all my flies is I draw out the hook. I do the outline of the hook. I then go back and put a mark where the end of the barb is on the paper. I go up and I put a mark where the gap is. And then I draw a box where those two lines meet. That's where the length of my tail is, and that's how high my wing should be. If you do this, you will have, and your hackle never goes below your hook gap there. If you do that, you'll have a perfectly proportioned fly for any hook that you tie on. So I look to see if that's a good, that looks good to me. I don't do anything to these feathers. I just tie them in. Anybody who's ever dealt with toppings, and this is a golden pheasant topping, knows that when they get wet, they do whatever they were going to do anyway. So I try to make sure that they're straight, and because I'm tying in hand, I can take a look. Measure it up, that looks good. At this point, this is a point where I put some varnish on because you're gonna cut this off and you don't want the tail to come out. Just a little dab of varnish. Okay, I'm gonna put a butt on this fly. Strip off a little bit. And then ostrich hurl has a rib in it, just like every other feather, and a good side and a back side. If you pull it back a little bit and look at it, you can tell where the rib is. So you point the rib up, take your tweezers, grab it, and push it away from you. This is something that Paul Rossman taught me. If you do that, then the fibers will always point to the back like they're supposed to, and generally you won't fight with it. And then these are very small, but sometimes if you use them larger, you can actually push it back like you would hackle. I take about 5 turns. And then see, I'm grabbing it, the material, moving it out of the way, and kind of grabbing the thread just to make that first turn. At this point, I trim off the tail, kind of at an angle. And my leftover floss. The next is tying in the rib. I'm gonna use a silver tinsel rib. Very common. This is actually real silver. You can use mylar. We're going to use, these flies all use pig's wool. There's one fly in all of Francis in the 1888 version that calls for seal. But predominantly they use pig's wool until about the 1880s. And my belief is that it's the under fur from wild boar, which they would, wild boar was basically what they used for domesticated pig. So I get pig skins out of Poland off of eBay, sit in the winter with a razor blade and take the bristles off, and then get the pig's wool and then dye it up. So it's coarser than seal, can be quite lovely to work with, I think. And what I do is just warm up some noodles ahead of time. Francis Hansen said, roll these in your hand, and that doesn't work for me, so I just roll them in my fingers. And at this point, I'm going to re-wax the thread. You want a nice, waxy, tacky thread for this part. And I do put hackle pliers as a weight just to hold that thread down. Get it started, and then make a turn to catch it. And then you can twist it into a nice rope. And basically, I usually make about three turns there. I put too much dubbing on this time. Because this is normally where I would put my hackle in. I'm just gonna tie that off. Oops. We're gonna attempt to tie that off. There we go. I've selected a hackle already for this. The way that you make sure that you've got the right size hackle is just to pull it back, and then you're going to end up down here with your hackle. Just measure it and make sure that it's not longer than your hook gap at the point where you think it's going to be at the throat. So that's about right. Now, if you are good at folding feathers, you can fold the feather beforehand. I use Indian necks, and they don't fold very well, so put it on the back of the fly. Tie it in. Spiral forward, and then I'm going to reform my noodle. Reapply the hackle pliers to give it some weight, and again, get it started, make a turn to catch it, and then you can continue to dub it on. Right. At this point, the thread is getting pretty short, so we're going to spiral forward, get another piece of thread, again about an arm's length,